Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Lakota America, A New History of Indigenous Power by Pekka Hamalainen. Narrated by Joe Barrett. A note on terminology. I use the word Sioux in this book as a cover term for seven related and allied people, or Oyates, the Lakotas, Yanktons, Yanktonais, Manawakontones, Sisseton's, Wahpetons, and Wahpakutis, who together form the Ouachita Shakowin, the Seven Council Fires. Sioux is a French corruption of an Ojibwe word, Nadui Sioux, which means snake, and thus enemy. Here I use Sioux when describing events or action that involve more than one or all peoples or Oyates. The alternative would have been to list each group in every instance. Although problematic, Sioux remains the most common English term used by Lakotas and non-natives alike, and many modern Lakota Oyates identify themselves as Sioux tribes. Dakota is a cover term for the four eastern people, the Manawakontones, Sissetons, Wahpetons, and Wahpakutis. The spelling of Lakota words follows New Lakota Dictionary, edited and compiled by Jan Ulrich. I have used Lakota names for the seven Lakota tribes or Oyates, unless a French or English name is dominant in the literature. Hunk Papas, head of Camp Circle Entrance, Mini Conjus, plant by water, Oglalas, scatter one's own, Sans Arcs, without bows, Sichonku, burned thighs, hence the French term brûlés, Sahasapas, black feet, and Two Kettles, two boilings. As for other native nations, I have used their preferred spellings of their names. Odawas rather than Ottawas, Musquakis rather than Foxes, Wyandots rather than Hurons, and Ho-Chunks rather than Winnebagos. Introduction. Dark matter of history. In 1776, two nations were born in North America. One was conceived in Philadelphia, the other in the Black Hills of South Dakota, and they were separated by more than 1,700 miles. Exactly a century later, those two nations would clash violently along the Little Bighorn River in what is today southern Montana. It was a collision between two radically different expanding powers that had conquered their way into the West, and its outcome was spectacular. Lakotas and their Cheyenne allies killed more than 200 soldiers of the 7th U.S. Cavalry, destroying five of its 12 companies. Remembered as Custer's Last Stand, the fight remains one of the most famous, intensely studied, and passionately debated battles in history. While the fight itself was not transformative, after all the railroad was coming and the buffalo were almost gone, its ironies and symbolic resonances are unparalleled, and it seems boundless. The worst defeat the United States suffered in the late 19th century Indian Wars, and on the cusp of its centennial, a ferocious, flamboyant Indian fighter meeting his fate at the hands of Indians who disposed of him routinely and effectively. A single death that has refused to die as a metaphor signifying for different ages heroism, ignorance, arrogance, and perhaps most pointedly savagery. First the Indians, later Custer's own. The Battle of the Little Bighorn was a moment when American history accelerated and turned violently. A perfect victory demanded a perfect retribution, and it sent the Indians into a spiraling decline and sealed the United States' continental hegemony. Within a year, Custer's Last Stand had spawned a reckoning that broke the power of the Lakotas and their allies in the Northern Plains. The Battle of the Little Bighorn fixed the Lakotas, embodied by Sitting Bull and Crazy Horse, in historical memory and made them an object of enduring fascination. A historical sequence that saw an indigenous power deliver a humiliating blow to a rising industrial behemoth, only to soon suffer a devastating defeat by the U.S. military, continues to mesmerize because its meanings resonate so broadly. From America's imperial hubris to the moral complexities of the Vietnam War, from the present-day struggles between nation-states and non-state actors to the confounding unpredictability of history itself. D. Brown's acclaimed work, Bury My Heart at Wounded Knee, remains the most read book on Native Americans, in part because it captured those meanings so evocatively. The Battle of the Little Bighorn has both elevated and diminished the Lakotas in the American mind. Like the battles of Yorktown and Gettysburg, it is a cultural touchstone around which American identity and self-understanding revolves. But unlike the American Revolution or the Civil War, the Lakota story lacks a comprehensive study. There are hundreds of superb works on different aspects of Lakota history, from social organization to religious life to the shifting relations with the United States, but most of them take the Little Bighorn as a guiding coordinate, tracing the immediate events, essentially the military buildup, leading up to it. Through a quick rearview look, Lakotas enter the scene fully formed as fierce horse-mounted hunter-warriors who give Lewis and Clark pause with their haughty confidence, a premonition of the carnage on the Little Bighorn three generations later. The Lakotas of our imagination are props that bookend America's westward expansion, present at its promise-filled inception and its morally ambivalent finale. For Lakotas, the clash with the United States, culminating in the horror of the Wounded Knee Massacre, was a shattering experience, but it did not define them as a people or their place in history. This book detaches their story from the mainstream historical coordinates, which have reduced them to a foil of the American condition. Here, the Lakotas emerge not as quintessential villains or victims, but as central and enduring protagonists who contended with a range of colonial powers since the 17th century, variously diverting, foiling, and boosting their ambitions. They emerge as superbly flexible people who went through a series of genesis from pedestrian foragers to sedentary farmers to equestrian hunters to nomadic pastoralists, each a precarious attempt to carve out a safe place in a world where European newcomers had become a permanent presence. They come to life as fiercely proud people who easily embraced outsiders, turning their domain into a vibrant ethnic jumble. Perhaps most strikingly, they emerge as supreme warriors who routinely eschewed violence, relying on diplomacy, persuasion, and sheer charm to secure what they needed, only to revert to naked force if necessary. When the overconfident Custer rode into the Bighorn Valley on that June day, they had already faced 1,000 imperial challenges. They knew exactly what to do with him. 2 centuries earlier, in the middle years of the 17th century, the Lakotas had been an obscure tribe of hunters and gatherers at the edge of a bustling new world of Native Americans and European colonists that had emerged in the eastern woodlands of North America. They had no guns and no metal weapons, and they carried little political clout, all of which spelled danger. The odds of survival were slim for people who lacked access to Europeans and their new technologies of killing. That crisis set off what may be the most improbable expansion in American history. Lakotas left their ancient homelands and reinvented themselves as horse people in the continental grasslands that stretched seemingly forever into the horizon. This was the genesis of what I call Lakota America, an expansive, constantly transmuting, indigenous regime that pulled numerous groups into its orbit, marginalized and dispossessed its rivals, both native and colonial, and commanded the political, social, and economic life in the North American interior for generations. Just as there were Spanish, French, British, and the United States of America, there was Lakota America, the sovereign domain of the Lakota people and their kin and allies, a domain they would protect and, if necessary, expand. A century later, the Lakotas had shifted the center of their world 300 miles west into the Missouri Valley, where they began to transform into a dominant power. Another century later, they were the most powerful indigenous nation in the Americas, controlling a massive domain stretching across the northern Great Plains into the Rocky Mountains and Canada. It was an expansion that in many ways should not have been possible. Lakotas collided with numerous native nations and maneuvered among 4 colonial empires, surviving endless crises. Yet they never numbered more than 15,000 people. They were not more warlike or necessarily better fighters than any of their Indian neighbors. They were creative and formidable diplomats, but so too were their native and non-native rivals. They had skillful leaders, but so did their adversaries. They believed that they had special access to otherworldly powers, but so did others. French, Spanish, British, and American colonists repeatedly underestimated their strategic proficiency, allowing them surprising openings. But in that, the Lakota experience was more typical than exceptional. And yet it was Lakotas who humiliated the world's most powerful nation in battle again and again, hindering its westward expansion for decades. The Lakotas and their story, in short, are puzzling. In this book, I attempt to unravel that puzzle. All societies possess more or less the same human potential for innovation, change, self-preservation, and aggression. The key to Lakota success, at the most elemental level, is that they did something slightly different and unexpected with their potential. This book is, in its essence, about that something. The central challenge in writing about the Lakotas is to make them unfamiliar again. Their mythical place in popular consciousness as the vanquishers of Custer and as the masters of the Western Plains has made their rise seem preordained. Even in the best histories, the Lakota expansion from the edge of the Great Lakes across America's heartland seems an inexorable march, driven by nearly limitless resources in the distance, buffalo, grass, space, and backed by an early access to guns and horses. Westward expansion was a foregone conclusion. Again, Custer's last stand as an attention-absorbing climax distorts, bending the Lakota history toward the there and then, and tricking us to accept one moment of apparent invincibility as a template for an entire history. Teleology, a sense that things were destined to unfold a certain way, has rendered the story of the Lakota ascendancy too simple and easy. It has abstracted it from human experience, sanitized it of uncertainty, and drained it of meaning. This book steps outside of those teleological currents by resisting the urge to drive the story to its assumed culmination. Alive to the ever-present possibility that events could have turned out differently, it seeks to restore a sense of contingency to the story. The book's very composition is geared to that end. It replaces the traditional story arc of beginning, climax, and resolution with a more unpredictable narrative structure that is full of triumphs, twists, reversals, victories, lulls, and low points, big and small. If the book's Lakotas, haughty and imperial at one moment, fearful and vulnerable the next, prudent and accommodating the third, seems strange and unfamiliar, this portrayal has succeeded. The Lakotas of this book may also seem unfamiliar in another, more elemental way. The Lakotas have become the embodiment of the horse-mounted Plains Indians, but here they spend most of their time in river valleys. Our understanding of the Lakotas has been distorted by what might be called the romance of the open plains. The continental grasslands, it suggests, exerted an irresistible pull on the newly equestrian Indians, who were drawn to their enormous bison herds, promise of unhindered movement, a potential for material and spiritual uplift. Such stories do capture an essential truth. The grasslands and their animal bounty did pull in Lakotas, whose foundation myths and values revolve around the bison and the hunt. But Lakota's greatest political and military ambitions always focused on the few river valleys that cut across the seemingly boundless grasslands. Indeed, the most formative chapter in their history, lasting for three generations, took place not in the plains, but on the banks of the Great Missouri. The mobile, horse-powered hunting way of life in the grasslands was a late development, a culmination of long history that has largely gone unnoticed. This book recovers the untold story of the Lakotas from the 16th into the 21st century, and it also recovers the story of the North American interior, the immense swath of land stretching from the Great Lakes to the Rocky Mountains, and from the Canadian Shield to the edges of the American South. The interior has long been a blind spot in American historical consciousness. In most histories of early America, the story centers on the continent's outer rim, where Europeans built colonial outposts and rooted themselves in the New World. This is where, supposedly, all the pivotal imperial rivalries over North America took place. France vying for supremacy with England on the eastern seaboard, Spaniards, Comanches, Mexicans, and Americans jostling for a position in the southwest, and Russians pushing down the Pacific coast in search of pelts and challenging Spain's claim to California. The interior world was a sideshow, too marginal to stir potent imperial passions, too vast and vicious for proper colonies. It was Thomas Jefferson's imagined Louisiana, whose settlement would take 1,000 generations. Jefferson's myopia will no longer do. The great interior, the setting of this book, was a dynamic, cosmopolitan, and intensely contested world. Dozens of Indian nations and four colonial powers sought to rule parts or all of it, producing a shifting constellation of expansions, conquests, retreats, and collapses. Here, for generations, Lakotas were key players within a larger coalition of seven Sioux nations, clashing or allying with nearly all the other contestants at one time or another. The Sioux Confederation was formidable, but it was also dangerously isolated, separated by numerous native rivals from the colonial frontiers where power-giving novelties, guns, powder, iron, flowed inland. Becoming central people, drawing Europeans and their goods to them, became an all-important quest for Lakotas and their allies. It was the most paradoxical of expansions, Indians cajoling European empires to come to them in a desperate effort to prevail over native rivals. It took roughly 100 years, but by the mid-18th century, the Sioux had succeeded. Their homelands between the Great Lakes and the Missouri Valley were a geopolitical hotspot where the most promising of the European imperial projects, New France, made its bid for continental hegemony with the Sioux nations on its side. It was then and there the Lakotas began to detach from the Sioux Confederation, launching an expansion of their own that saw them becoming the dominant people in the Great Interior. It was a massive gamble. Drawn by bison and horses in the West, they were pulling away from the major continental trade corridors, entering a strange new world in the Western Plains that was on the verge of transforming from a backwater into an imperial crossroads. As Lakotas shifted westward, an array of competing empires rushed in, seeking to control the deep interior and its rivers, wealth of furs, and thousands of potential native allies, only to realize that the interior was not theirs for the taking. The Spanish, French, British, and American empires did not simply clash in the heart of the continent, they converged on the expanding Lakota realm. How Lakotas harnessed that imperial cauldron to serve their interests, how they learned to cut the newcomers to size, is one of the great untold stories in American history. By the time Lewis and Clark plunged, quite innocently so, into the cauldron in 1804, Lakotas were ascendant people who saw themselves as the rightful rulers of the North American interior. Like the French, British, and Spaniards before them, Americans had to readjust their imperial ambitions around Lakota ones. The great paradox of Lakota history is that by helping prevent the realization of other Wests, French, British, Spanish, Lakotas inadvertently paved the way for an American West and eventually their own downfall. And as the pages that follow will show, for half a century after the Louisiana Purchase, Lakota and U.S. interests converged rather than collided. The two nations pushed westward in tandem as military allies and trading partners. Lakotas transformed themselves into formidable equestrian people capable of shaping human fates on a vast scale, and Americans were their firm allies, one of the many peoples who had realized where power lay. How this happened, how two expansionist people managed to coexist in the same space, each feeling safe and certain of its supremacy, is a historical conundrum that needs an explanation. It also requires a new way of looking at Indian-white relations, empires, and space. North American historical writing has a long tradition in the study of cross-cultural relations and has spawned a number of models, the frontier, the borderland, the middle ground, that help explain how different societies and cultures have clashed and coexisted in the past. A set of assumptions, some clearly articulated, others more vaguely sensed, runs through this scholarship. That a collision of two expanding powers must result in either a retreat or a borderland where power and authority are perpetually contested, that empires are mutually repelling organisms that can overlap only at their far-flung edges, and that mutual weakness, inability to dictate terms to others, is the necessary ingredient for enduring coexistence between Indians and colonists. The history of the Lakota-U.S. relations challenges all those assumptions. Lakotas and Americans expanded simultaneously into the West, often claiming the same tracts of land and water. Their regimes overlapped and interpenetrated rather than brushed against one another, and yet they managed to coexist for two generations, well into the 1850s. How and why this happened was an outcome of many factors, but one was crucial. Neither Lakotas nor Americans compromised their core convictions about themselves and the world. Convinced of the essential rightness of their respective beliefs and principles, he created a yawning mental crevasse where two expansionist powers could fit. They valued, desired, sought, and fought for different things and often talked past one another, which, ironically, made them compatible. It was only when nature itself failed to sustain both that coexistence became impossible. The rise and might of the Lakotas, symbolized by the Lakota-U.S. wars of the 1860s and 1870s, was thus much more than some anomaly in a history that was rolling irresistibly toward U.S. hegemony. Expansion, territorial, commercial, and cultural, had transformed the Lakotas into an imperial power in the midst of another. Seen against this background, the Great Sioux Wars and the Battle of the Little Bighorn take on drastically new meanings. Lakotas were fighting for survival, to protect the bison and their sovereignty, but they were also fighting to keep alive a broader vision of America where coexistence through right thoughts and acts might be possible. By 1876, that vision had guided them for two centuries, pushing them into successful alliances with France, Britain, Spain, the United States, and numerous native societies, keeping them powerful and safe. It was all but unthinkable to Lakotas that this America had run its course. It is only in the last few decades that Native Americans have entered history as full-fledged protagonists. Earlier, for centuries, Native people lingered in the recesses of the American imagination as a kind of dark matter of history. Scholars tended to look right through them into peoples and things that seemed to matter more, that seemed to move history. Conquistadors, monarchs, founding fathers, settler empires, nation-states, global capitalist markets. The Indians were a hazy frontier backdrop, the necessary other whose menacing presence heightened the colonial drama of forging a new people and a new world. While persisting in popular consciousness as America's foundation myth, those stories now seem hopelessly outdated, relics of another time and of different sensibilities. Today, Native Americans occupy the center stage as powerful historical actors who thwart colonial intrusions, reverse expected power dynamics, force newcomers to adapt to their way of doing things, and profoundly shape the creation of a distinctly American identity. The scholarly pendulum has swung abruptly, perhaps too abruptly. If Native Americans were for a long time stunted as historical agents, today it is the colonists and settlers who seem to be in danger of becoming caricatured, their motives and ambitions simplified, their complexity flattened. With the Indians commanding the center stage, the whites often appear as a monolithic mass hell-bent on conquest or as weak, helpless pawns in intricate indigenous politics they could neither understand nor control. I have been guilty of such simplifying myself, and I have aimed for a more balanced exposition in this book. I have tried to keep all the protagonists, Lakotas and their kin, the many native peoples they had dealings with, and the French, Spanish, British, and American colonists who came to them, in their frame as rounded historical figures. This has meant taking the ideals, anxieties, and ambitions of the colonists seriously, tracing how they clashed and intertwined with native ones, and how Lakotas and European newcomers created lasting shared worlds even when they misunderstood, hated, and killed one another. Yet this book is decidedly a history of the Lakotas, written from sources that seek to convey their perspective, often in their own words. Its overarching ambition is to understand how they saw the world and shaped American history. An extraordinary archive makes this possible to an unusual degree. Lakota communities trace the passage of time by drawing on a buffalo hide a pictograph of one memorable event for each year. Lakotas called these calendars Waniyutu Iyawapi. Waniyutu means to be winter, and Iyawapi to count. At once a record of the past and an act of remembering, of giving meaning to the past, winter counts are a unique source that allow us to capture the astounding variety and raw immediacy of Lakota experiences. Often emotionally charged, they show not only what happened, but also how Lakotas felt about events and outcomes. They allow us to see Lakotas as dynamic and often contradictory people, formidable and full of bravado at one moment, in the grip of despair the next, then absorbed with internal politics and social drama. They draw attention to the mundane and reveal the sublime. Perhaps most important, As a body of historical record, winter accounts capture what fascinated Lakotas and what mattered to them most. They uncover how Lakotas shaped their histories through selective narration and how their understanding of the past and themselves changed over time. They most emphatically do not adhere to Euro-American accounts of major historical events and developments. They open an alternative, counter-hegemonic window into the American past, allowing us to observe native motives and meanings directly, without a foreign filter. Lakota America makes the fullest use yet of this indigenous archive in writing Lakota history. The great pitfall of Native American history is a tendency to homogenize its protagonists, to portray Indians as staunch traditionalists averse to new things and ideas, or as pragmatists resigned to the incongruities of the modern world. I do not want to essentialize the Lakotas, nor do I want to make them consistent. This book takes its cue from Iktomi, an ambiguous shape-shifting spider trickster culture hero who embodies what is perhaps the defining characteristic of the Lakota people: their stunning ability and willingness to change. Like Iktomi, Lakotas were and are shapeshifters with a palpable capacity to adapt to changing conditions around them and yet remain Lakotas. Recurring metamorphosis, fragmenting and coalescing into smaller and larger units, enabled Lakotas to mobilize power on multiple registers and in various capacities, not only as bands and tribes, but also as a nation and as leaders of large indigenous alliances. By the time Lakotas came in close contact with the U.S. government in the early 1850s, they were in the midst of what was perhaps the most remarkable and least known of their self-reinventions. By 1876, that transfiguration was complete and reached its symbolic culmination in the Battle of the Little Bighorn. Custer failed to see that change and led his men to certain death. He was not brought down by a mere alliance of Indians. He was brought down by the Lakota Empire. When I started researching and writing this book, I knew to expect certain things about Lakotas and their history. Some of my assumptions turned out to be correct, more or less, but much of the writing was an exercise of recalibrating expectations. I knew Lakotas were highly adaptable people, all Indians had to be, to survive settler colonialism, but their capacity to reimagine their place in the world over and over again took me by surprise. I knew they were powerful, but I could not foresee finding them shaping American history on almost a continental scale, expanding not only westward, but also deep into the south and far to the north. I knew they were superior fighters, but was astounded how often they forced things by restraining action. I knew that they were great orators, but I did not know just how searing and historically significant their use of irony could be when facing colonial agents. But the most elemental surprise was their sheer ubiquity. Lakotas and their kin were Native Americans who received 8-gun salutes in Quebec, inspired fear from the Mississippi Valley to the Continental Divide, ranged from the deserts of Utah to the Canadian plains, commanded the attention of the great global fur trading conglomerates, and agreed to be feted in imperial centers in Montreal, St. Louis, New York, and Washington, D.C. That their most famous leader would tour the East to enormous crowds was less surprising than it was predictable. The story begins not in the open plains of the West, but in the eastern woodlands around the Great Lakes, where the main protagonists are not the Lakotas, but the Dakotas, their close kin. In the 17th century, the Dakotas were the most powerful members of the Sioux Confederation, and they held the center stage in Sioux politics for generations. But gradually, as the Lakotas transformed into an equestrian power and turned westward, they emerged from behind the Dakotas as the foremost Sioux division. A people reborn on horseback, they peeled off from other Sioux tribes, shedding old assumptions of the possible. But they also carried into the West a deep understanding of European newcomers, accumulated over a century of living on the fringes of French and British colonies in the East. Lakotas knew what Europeans were, what colonialism was, how empires operated, and how thin the line separating violence from conciliation would have to be. That knowledge was their greatest asset as they pushed into new worlds beyond the horizon. 1. A Place in the World. In the summer of 1695, two Indian emissaries embarked on a nearly 1,000-mile journey from the western Great Lakes to Montreal. One was Jingobin, a Sauteur chief, and the other Teoshkate, a war leader of the Mentantone band of the Metawakantone Sioux. Five French traders guided their fleet of some dozen canoes. The two emissaries had a common purpose, for they were carrying an offer of peace and alliance to the French, but their journeys east could hardly have been more different. Jingobin was traveling through Sauteur lands and among allies, and many of the Indians and French traders and priests he met along the way were friends and kin. Teoshkate, however, was entering a war zone. His people had been fighting the Great Lakes Indians for decades, and only the presence of Jingobin and the French now kept him alive. He may well have been the first Sioux to travel east, neither to kill nor as a slave. When the convoy arrived in the island city in mid-July, Teoshkate stepped into a new world. Along the shoreline sat massive vessels with towering poles draped in ropes and sheets, and the island itself was a jumble of sharp angles, soaring vertical walls, and the amplified sounds of confined spaces. A stench of excrement, animal entrails, and rot hung everywhere. The city was also teeming with Indians. At the behest of the governor of New France, Louis de Boade, Comte de Frontenac, hundreds of native envoys had gathered there, desperate to put an end to violence that was ruining their homelands. To maintain order in his crammed city, Frontenac had brought in much of the French colonial army, and an honor guard of 700 regulars, militia, and natives received Teoshkate and Jingobin in front of the council chamber, where they were to meet the governor. The soldiers carried what Teoshkate's people needed most, guns. When the council began, the person whose voice was heard most was Pierre-Charles Le Sueur, an explorer-trader and Frontenac's favorite. He was one of the Frenchmen who had escorted Jingobin and Teoshkate to Montreal, and fluent in several native languages, now served as a translator. Jingobin spoke first, asking the governor to sanction a war against the Musquaque people who had killed many Sioux. Sioux now wanted to raise their dead by taking the war to Musquaques with Sauteur's help. Sioux came to cry with us, he said. Father, let us have revenge. Next to speak was Genoche, an Odawa leader who urged the governor to embrace the Sioux, a bellicose nation that would make for a formidable ally. Odawas, he said, had already accepted Sioux as their allies and kin, ending years of deadly warfare. He urged the governor to do the same. It was Teoshkate's turn. The young warrior spread two beaver robes at Frontenac's feet and began to weep. After crying bitterly, pleading the governor to have pity on him, he dried his eyes and spoke. All the nations have a father who gives them his protection and his iron, he said, but I am a bastard searching for a father. He laid 22 arrows on the robes, naming a village of his nation with each, and asked the governor to send his traders to all of them. He begged the governor, the master of iron, to accept him as one of his children and bring his guns and iron weapons to his people. Take courage, great captain, he said. Reject me not, despise me not. Though I appear miserable in his eyes, he pleaded. All the nations that are present here know that I am rich, and the little they offer you is taken on my lands. What he meant was a wealth of beaver pelts, the raison d'etre of the French fur trade, two samples of which lay at the governor's feet. It was common knowledge that Sioux lands were the richest sources of thick winter pelts in the West. A veteran frontier administrator, Frontenac, understood Teoshkate's plea and its performative nature. Like so many before him, this Indian wanted his pity because pity evoked compassion and created obligations. Pity promoted, indeed demanded, a relationship. In begging the governor to be his father, the Indian was asking him to arm and thereby protect his people and, if necessary, to go to war for them. The young chief wanted Frontenac to be the father of the Sioux, but on Sioux terms. He was asking him to be generous with his iron, but he also wanted him to be gentle and compassionate. Teoshkate expected him to give guns and iron, not orders. Word of the governor's benevolence, he said, compelled me to abandon my body to come request for his protection. For that, the Indian expected the same from him, to abandon his body, to think and act like Sioux, and to transform himself into a kin of the Sioux. Frontenac was to give himself and become one with them. Like his predecessors, Frontenac was Onontio, Great Mountain, and a father to France's Indian allies, who were his children. Both a title and a social role, Onontio mediated quarrels among his children and cared for their needs. In return, he expected loyalty. True children of Onontio traded only with the French and went to war against the enemies of the French. When Frontenac embraced Teoshkate and his people as his children, he did so on condition that he would listen only his father's voice. Once more Teoshkate wept, now clasping the governor's legs, and said, "Take pity on me. I know well that I am incapable of speaking to you, being still but a child. But things would change," he continued. "With the French on their side, Sioux would grow stronger, and Frontenac would soon see what they could do when they had the protection of such a good father who will send them Frenchmen to bring them iron, of which they are only starting to have knowledge. Sioux would grow from children into allies, and they would learn to speak properly to their fathers. They would be equals." Teoshkate did not live to see it through. Cross-cultural diplomacy in 17th-century North America was an intensely physical affair that involved handshakes, embraces, kisses, and tears. It may have been in one such encounter in Montreal that Teoshkate contracted an alien pathogen. The pathogen developed into an illness that killed him after a month's struggle. No one carried his bones home. They remained in Montreal. His hope would have been that the French would dig him up once in a while, hold them, think of good thoughts, and then put them back, but it is unlikely that anyone asked about his last wishes. Iron Frontier. The threats and frustrations that brought Teoshkate to Montreal in 1695 had eaten away at his people for half a century. The Sioux homeland, a fertile realm of forests, marshes, and lush grasslands around the upper Mississippi River watershed, had become a dangerous place. Sioux knew exactly the reason why. Washichus, people with other than human abilities, had appeared, wielding extraordinary powers. Long before Sioux would meet these people, they learned about their power, which manifested itself in various forms. In fire-spitting sticks, whose tiny projectiles killed from distances greater than a bowshot, in consciousness-altering liquid that eased spiritual transcendence, in diseases that consumed entire villages, in the softness of their fabrics, which gently hugged human bodies and dried remarkably fast, in the hardness of the iron that could slice through flesh and bone with astounding ease. The Washichus arriving with guns and iron were formidable, but they were also curiously generous with their wondrous novelties. A few well-worn beaver pelts could produce an iron knife, an axe, or a kettle. European traders preferred used pelts that had lost their coarse outer hair but retained the thick, soft under fur. The French colonists who pushed up the St. Lawrence Valley in the early 17th century had forged an alliance with a powerful Wyandot nation, granting them privileged access to their wares in exchange for beaver skins. Wyandots became middlemen who carried French goods from Montreal into the Great Lakes in the west, a region the French knew as Pays d'Onot, or Upper Country, and brought back pelts procured from many native groups. By the 1630s, a sprawling trading network, anchored in Montreal and run by Wyandots, stretched deep into the interior all the way to western Lake Superior. The quest for French iron drew the Sioux into war. The main enemies were the Crees, powerful hunter-gatherers who ranged across a vast belt between Hudson Bay and the Great Lakes. Cree bands occupied the forests on the northern shores of Lake Superior, where they were within reach of the castor-rich Sioux country to the west and the burgeoning French Wyandot fur trade to the east. When Crees made contact with Wyandot traders, Sioux immediately felt the repercussions. Cree war parties seeking beaver started to appear, fighting with iron axes and knives. The Sioux borderlands to the northwest became a war zone, where bands gathered together for defense. "Their villages are larger and in a better state of defense," a French Jesuit reported in 1641, "owing to their continual wars with the Crees." Sioux were on the receiving end of violence because their border with Crees had become a technological frontier. Crees now had iron weapons, Sioux were isolated and ironless. Their age-old alliance with the Siouan-speaking Assiniboines, with whom they shared an ancestral connection, had unraveled, either over a woman or bison meat, according to oral traditions, and they had no ties to the French. When Jesuit missionaries met with a large native assembly, probably Anishinaabemowin-speaking Sautour Indians, at the rapids between Lake Superior and Huron in 1641, they learned of a certain nation, the Nanduisees, who lived 18th day's journey further away and have never known Europeans and have never heard of God. Sautours, aspiring trapper-traders, seem to have depicted the Sioux as peripheral and uncouth to discourage French overtures to them. It worked. French colonists came to know them as Nanduisieux, a corruption of an Anishinaabe term, Natawasiwak, which means someone who speaks a foreign language. The Sioux had entered French consciousness as people beyond the pale. The Sioux were distanced from the French not only mentally. Nearly half a continent separated them from New France, and between them and the French traders lay dozens of native nations, all of them inside the gun and iron frontier, and all of them familiar with the European newcomers and their strange ideas and habits. All of these odds were stacked against the Sioux in ways they did not know. Each of those nations would have to be won over, pushed aside, or otherwise neutralized for the Sioux to find a secure place in the world. They were at once one of the most isolated and boxed-in people in North America. Ocheti Shakowi. The Sioux may have been isolated, but they were not defenseless. Crees and Sautours fought with iron, but they were widely scattered and loosely organized. Sioux fought with stone, bone, and sinew, but they were numerous and united. Their numbers were estimated around 30,000 in mid-17th century, and their many villages possessed a strong sense of common identity as the Ocheti Shakowi, the Seven Council Fires. The Ocheti Shakowi was an alliance of seven Oyates, or people, who understood themselves as relatives and were bound to one another and the universe by a pervasive life-giving essence, Wakan. The Oyates spoke different dialects and occupied distinct sections of their shared realm, having moved northwestward from their ancestral lands in the central Mississippi Valley over several centuries and in several stages. They were part of a larger movement of Siouan-speaking peoples who variously competed and cooperated with one another, gradually assuming distinct identities as they jostled for position. The Great Siouan Exodus was triggered by a warmer and wetter climate cycle that began in the 9th century, rendering the lands in the previously colder north and drier west more appealing. The collapse of the Mississippian mound-building cultures and their great center in Cahokia from the 12th century onward gave a further impetus to the already itinerant Siouans. For centuries, commercial gravity had pulled people toward Cahokia and the Mississippi Valley. As that pull faded, people scattered, seeking new attachments. The ancestral Sioux shifted slowly northwestward until they reached the pine oak forests that were spreading to the west from the Great Lakes under the wet conditions. The Manawakontans, Sisseton's, Wapakutis, and Wahpetons, collectively known as the Dakotas, laid down roots first, settling in the marshy woodlands between Leech Lake and the St. Croix River. Converging around Wakan, Mille Lacs, their sacred lake, these four Oyates became the eastern face of the Ocheti Shakowi. The Yanktons and the Yanktonais pushed farther, eventually clustering their villages around the upper Mississippi Valley. The Lakotas, or the Teton Oyata, a derivation from Titunwa, prairie village, pushed farthest, settling on the lands toward the Minnesota Valley. This was North America's ecological hinge, a transition zone where eastern woodlands and western grasslands met and overlapped, offering an unusual opulence of plant and animal life. Migratory animals, deer, elk, and especially bison, thrived there, shifting nimbly between habitats, inviting people to do the same. Lakotas did, and became the most mobile of the Seven Council Fires. Their range extended ever deeper into the west during the cool and moist Little Ice Age, when both grasses and bison proliferated. The herds were many, and often numbered in the thousands, each animal yielding at least 650 pounds of food, pulling Lakotas in. Lakota traditions depict the West as both frightening and irresistible, a place where extraordinary people lived and where Iktomi wanted them to go. Their winter counts record great Western gatherings from the 15th century onward. One of those spiritually charged meeting places was Pipestone Quarry, more than 200 miles west, of the Mississippi Valley, where malleable reddish catlinite, ideal for making sacred pipes, was readily available. Gray communal bison hunts, possibly in the West, appear in Lakota winter counts in the early 16th century. The Otetchi-Shakowin was not a formal state or a confederacy. It had no overarching governing structure or leaders who could speak for all members of the alliance. It was instead a manifestation of deep voluntary attachments that bound the seven fires together, the sacred number seven echoing the ancient unity of Sioux as a people. The Otetchi-Shakowin was constructed from the bottom up, with language and kinship as its main cohesive. Its three major divisions, the Dakotas, Yankton-Yanktonais, and Lakotas, spoke different dialects, but all could understand one another, and the seven Oyates saw themselves as real people, who were distinguished from strangers and Tokas, enemies. Yet Sioux kinship was not exclusivist. For them, belonging was a matter of behavior rather than blood. Anybody capable of proper sentiments, words, and deeds could become a relative, Tokuya. From this mindset arose a confederation that was at once durable and exquisitely supple. Sioux's primary social setting was Teoshpaya, a local band that stayed together year-round, forming a camp circle that could include more than 20 households, the round shape a manifestation of spiritual unity and cosmological order. The people with whom they shared a village were their first and best shield against the hostile world beyond, but they were also their main rivals for status and power. They were likely to marry someone in their village and village life to find their identity. Each Oyata consisted of several Teoshpayes, and each commanded a distinct territory, but the Otetchi-Shakowin was not fixed in space. It was a human kaleidoscope, where individuals, families, and bands moved around constantly, arranging themselves in different constellations as circumstances demanded. In the late 17th century, their villages were known to range from a few families to hundreds of people. Instead of fragmenting the Otetchi-Shakowin, the constant movement stitched it tighter together by creating a thick lattice of kinship ties that transcended local and regional identities. Sioux traced descent through both maternal and paternal lines, which maximized their potential to forge connections. Most Sioux had relatives spread across many Teoshpayes and Oyates. They could travel anywhere within their realm and always be among kin. Ties of kinship, Otakuya, held the Sioux together, but so did the fear and aversion of outsiders who denounced Sioux mores and remained Tokas. Sioux went to war for complex reasons: to protect their lands, to exact revenge, to secure hunting and trading privileges, to enhance their power and prestige by taking slaves, to preempt threats. And the threshold for a military campaign was low. Any Sioux could initiate one by visiting villages and inviting warriors to a feast and a dance, which turned war into a collective sacred endeavor. As they came together, warriors sang songs that anticipated the submission and metaphorical absorption of the enemy. I am going to war. I will revenge the death of such a kinsman. I will slay, I will burn, I will bring away slaves, I will eat men. Sioux called the feast Shunkalawanpi, ceremonial song of the dog. The fate of the slaves was also decided collectively by elders who listened to the warriors' accounts. Women who had lost fathers in battle received slaves and had the right to decide whether they lived or died. Men who had distinguished themselves in battle received captives to marry, to build up their households, and to bolster their masculine status. Certain of their fighting prowess and ability to eat strangers, to subjugate and neutralize them like they would domesticate dogs, the interconnected Oyatas of the Otetchi-Shakowin could mobilize massive numbers of warriors against their enemies. Known by their neighbors as very strong, Sioux kept Crees and Sauteurs at bay. By the mid-17th century, the violence seems to have abated to an off-and-on-again borderland skirmish that sustained a neutral zone between the three powers. Although the competition for furs and iron had made their place in the world uncertain, Sioux remained powerful and relatively safe. What kept them safe in the end was the land itself. The Seven Fires commanded a vast domain stretching southeastward from Mdawakan, the center of the world, and tracing the Mississippi, Kaha Wakba, River of the Falls, near the Wisconsin River confluence, where it curved northwestward, bulging out toward the northern latitudes, where prairie meets forest. The Mississippi and Minnesota bracketed their core territory, a roughly 60,000 square mile mix of pine and broadleaf forests, marshes, parklands, and prairie. It was a superbly fertile domain that almost invariably impressed newcomers. In the fall, countless lakeside stands of marsh rye, wild rice, seemed to yield abundant crops without any culture or sowing, although women probably molded the soil to get larger harvests. Women dried the rice and later boiled it into a broth that sustained their villages through winters. In the spring and summer, large schools of fish moved up the rivers, surrendering impressive catches, and Mdewahan teemed with muskellunge, a large predatory fish. Spring was also the time to tap maple trees for juice, which Sioux boiled into syrup. In the summer, there were wild oats, berries, plums, nuts, wild turnips, and mdo, a potato-like plant. Deer, elk, ducks, and geese flourished in the forests and around the lakes, and west of the Minnesota began the prairie of towering tall grasses where massive herds of bison could be found in the summer and early fall. So bountiful was their domain that Sioux could feed a growing population essentially through wild foods and game alone. Sioux women did grow small crops of corn, but their lands were near the northern limit of corn cultivation, and the harvests were unreliable. Farming was a supplementary resource that helped maintain a diet that many modern nutritionists would consider almost ideal. Moderate or high in protein, moderate in complex carbohydrates, and low in saturated fat. They probably received enough iron and vitamin B12, not too much cholesterol or sodium, and sufficient amounts of the essential omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids. The Sioux are often thought of as quintessential people of the plains and the hunt, but that was a later development. In the 17th century, they were consummate generalists who exploited multiple habitats, moving among woodlands, parklands, grasslands, and marshlands in a carefully attuned annual cycle. Indeed, theirs was very much a watery world. Women harvested wild rice from birch bark canoes by pulling the stalks down over the side and gently beating the grain into their canoes with sticks. Men performed many of their duties, policing borders, visiting allies, moving trade goods with light and fast canoes. Bands traveled to communal ceremonies, political gatherings, and war in fleets. One early observer portrayed them a wandering nation that commanded a vast country. In winter, they live in the land for the hunting's sake, and in summer by the water for fishing. By 1650, a modicum of stability had settled in the Sioux realm, which had been rocked by French markets, enemy trappers, and iron weapons. A new hybrid world of Indians, colonists, and commerce had expanded deep into the west, butting against Sioux borders and then faltering there. But unknowns to Sioux, that distant new world in the east had already imploded, ripped apart by disease, death, and unprecedented violence. The ensuing chaos engulfed the northeast and then washed over the Great Lakes. The turmoil reached the Sioux in the late 1650s and nearly broke them. Never have I seen anything like this. In the fall of 1638, a delegation of Jesuit missionaries met with Wyandots in the Great Lakes. Looking like men who already feel the terrors of death, the Indians spoke in sighs, which only seemed to incite them to vomit more bitterly upon us the venom which they concealed within. An old chief addressed the priests, "I am obliged to speak here since all the other captains are dead. Now, before I follow them to the grave, I must free my mind, and perhaps it will be for the good of the country, which is going to ruin. Every day it is worse than before. This cruel malady has now overrun all the cabins of our village, and has made such ravages in our own family that, lo, we're reduced to 2 persons, and I do not yet know whether we shall escape the fury of this demon. I have seen maladies in the country before, but never have I seen anything like this." The malady was an extraordinarily virulent smallpox outbreak that had begun in Massachusetts in 1633. The death toll was staggering. More than 80% of New England Indians perished within a year. John Winthrop, a leading Massachusetts colonist, saw a divine intervention in that. "I am still as full of company and business as before," he wrote to a fellow Puritan in England, But for the natives of these parts, God's hand hath so pursued them, as for 300 miles space, the greatest part of them are swept away by the smallpox, which still continues among them. So as God hath hereby cleared our title to this place. From New England, native traders and warriors, the continent's most mobile people, transported the pox in all directions, carrying the multiplying virus in their seemingly sound bodies while it incubated, a window of 10 to 17 days on average. Fast-moving parties could cover vast distances before expiring, and soon the zone of death extended from the Atlantic coast to the Appalachians and from the Chesapeake Bay to the St. Lawrence Valley. The pandemic killed European settlers and their African slaves everywhere it went, but in relatively modest numbers. Long exposure to smallpox and other viral diseases had fortified their ancestors' immune systems against crowd illnesses, which had gradually evolved into childhood diseases. For Native Americans, however, viral diseases were a lethal novelty. No one had acquired immunity against them, a vulnerability that was greatly magnified by the colonists who destroyed Indian crops and food caches to generate disastrous bouts of famine. Their immune systems were also more homogeneous than those of Europeans, which rendered them more vulnerable to infections. Once adapted to their relatively uniform immunological responses, pathogens could jump bodies with relative ease, spreading and killing much faster than in more heterogeneous populations. Entire villages could be inflicted within days, and entire regions within weeks. The St. Lawrence Great Lakes Trade Corridor became a disease corridor, channeling the pox far downriver in the east, to Lake Huron in the west, to Hudson Bay in the north, and to the Chesapeake Bay in the south. About half of the natives in that vast expanse died. The death toll was equally devastating among the Haudenosaunee, the five nations of the Iroquois League, whose lands around Lake Ontario and along the upper Hudson River were surrounded by English, Dutch, and French outposts. About half of them, 10,000 people, had perished by the time the pox had run its course in 1641. Shattered worlds emerged everywhere in the pandemic's wake. Unburied bodies remained rotting on the ground, ghastly reminders of broken families and lineages. Starvation sapped villages that had lost too many hunters or farmers. Native converts turned against their missionaries, who seemed curiously invulnerable to the malady, killing them in rage. Despair and sorrow gripped entire communities, spawning apathy or increasingly violence to ease the pain. Mourning Wars. Death demanded war, and nowhere as potently as among the five Iroquois nations. With the loss of half of their population, their world had suddenly become a deadly and menacing place. Iroquois' central location, in the midst of several indigenous and colonial realms, once an advantage, turned into a liability. How could a confederacy that had lost half of its fighting power hold on to its extensive territory in a fiercely competitive milieu where multiple peoples jostled for power? Rather than turning inward, trying to cling to what they had, the Iroquois exploded outward. They had lost too many people and now needed new ones. They went to war to make Iroquois out of others. The result was warfare more ferocious than anyone could remember. Iroquois war parties pushed north and west, raiding across a widening zone in months-long summer campaigns. A massive invasion broke the Wyandot world of villages, the people of each scattering where they could. The Iroquois pursued the refugees to the interior, chasing them into the western Great Lakes. Once again, people fled, and once again the Iroquois followed, now targeting virtually anyone they ran into. Several nations crumbled as political entities, and scores of Musqueam, Kickapoos, Potawatomis, Odawas, and others abandoned their villages, retreating in the face of the most concentrated projection of power in 17th century North America. A swelling diaspora carried fugitives deep into the forests of the western Great Lakes, where distance gave them a measure of safety. In the mid-1650s, the Iroquois dispersed the remaining Eries and then moved the war to the south against the Shawnees. An enormous swath of land between the Ohio Valley and the northern Great Lakes became virtually empty of people. It had become an Iroquois shatter zone. Iroquois war parties carried thousands of war prisoners into Iroquois, where clan matrons slated them for slavery, adoption, or execution. Many, mostly women, became slaves who labored as farmers, household workers, and mothers. Many, almost invariably men, were re-quickened to cover dead kin. They were adopted into Iroquois clans and assumed the social role and name of the deceased, thereby repairing fractured lineages as newly born Iroquois. Some male captives were adopted and then killed to atone for slain relatives. Their bodies were cut up and boiled in a kettle. Whole villages joined in feasts where they consumed the corporal and spiritual power of their enemies, preserving it for new purposes. The Iroquois never invaded the lands of the Ocheti Shokowi, and if they ever captured or killed any Sioux, there is no record of it. Yet the Iroquois Wars profoundly changed the history of the Seven Fires. The thousands of Indians who fled the fury of the Iroquois to the western Great Lakes were refugees, traumatized and desperate people in a foreign land that seemed the very end of the world. But soon they forged a new order out of the fragments of the old and made the strange lands their own. This entrenchment spelled trouble for the Sioux. An entire indigenous world, alien and menacing, had materialized on their borders, alive with otherworldly powers. These newcomers not only had iron, they had guns. The politics of pity. The thousands of refugees who fled the Iroquois to the western Great Lakes had not entered empty lands. The lands belonged to Odawas, Ojibways, Sauteurs, and others whose mobile villages dotted the area, clustering around strategic lakeshore locations at the Straits of Mackinac and Sault Ste. Marie. At first there was violence, but the unremitting Iroquois pressure drove people to seek safety in numbers. Resident Indians opened their villages to emigrants who made their new homes points of resistance against the Iroquois. Intermarriage expanded and thickened long-standing kinship lineages, Nindodamak, which fostered cooperation across political and clan boundaries. Feasting, gifting, dancing, and sharing the sacred calumet pipe, they created a space of transcendence, where they could connect with unearthly powers and reimagine the newcomers as allies. Carefully, through a thousand ceremonies, they ushered the foreigners into their homeland, Anishinaabewaki, which encompassed most of the lands around the Great Lakes. Most refugees pushed deeper into the interior, seeking sanctuary west of Lake Michigan. There they merged with the resident Indians, who had no choice but to weather the emigrant surge. Local villages bulged into dynamic mixed villages, and new loyalties began to cohere. A measure of stability fell over this refugee world that stretched in a triangular shape from the upper Illinois River to both ends of Lake Superior. The greatest concentration of villages was in the middle, around Green Bay, where some 10,000 Indians resided, desperate for normalcy, belonging, and trade. The refugee triangle became a magnet for far-ranging independent French traders who lived in the West, and in the eyes of their countrymen along the St. Lawrence Valley, seemed to have gone native. The budding interior fur trade had ground to a near halt during the Iroquois Wars, leaving New France without robes and revenue. A restart became possible in 1654 when the Iroquois agreed to a peace with the French. Craving guns and iron, Wyandots immediately guided more than 100 Indians, mostly Odawas, to Trois-Rivières in the upper St. Lawrence Valley. Médard Choix de Groseillers, a veteran trader who had lost his livelihood with the collapse of the fur trade, joined the Odawas on their journey back west. 2 years later, he returned to Trois-Rivières with 50 fur-laden canoes, which spoke of immense western riches. Beaver populations had boomed during a trapping hiatus, and the interior rivers and lakes were teeming with castor. Although the Iroquois War soon flared up again, the inland trade persisted. Odawas emerged as a key broker regime, running a burgeoning traffic that connected the American interior to Atlantic markets. Managing such a prodigious multi-ethnic trade network was a daunting logistical undertaking, but it posed an even greater cultural challenge. Answers to that challenge spawned an extraordinary small new world in the heart of the continent. As the refugee villages morphed into trade centers, the French and the Indians had to find ways to coexist despite the yawning cultural gap that separated them. Neither possessed the power to dictate to the other, and so they were forced to accommodate one another. Through trial and error, they learned how to listen, how to pull back, and how to reconcile inevitable disputes over authority, trade protocols, crimes, punishments, and sex. They learned not to impose their own customs, but to rather appeal to what they thought were the meanings and practices of the other, practices that often seemed absurd and outright repellent. Often they misunderstood one another and frequently chose to misread one another, but out of those distortions emerged new meanings on which a fragile shared world, a middle ground, could be built. The compromises took many forms. Hard bargaining over goods blended into gift-giving, in which fictive kin shared possessions. Much of the trade in skins and furs was conducted by Indian women, whom the French simultaneously sought as sexual partners and sometimes married à la façon du pays, according to the custom of the country. Murderers of French traders were condemned to death, only to be pardoned and then raised with slaves or covered with presents. Indians appealed to their distant father in Montreal to look after their needs, and Onontio pretended to command his dutiful children through kindness and generosity. The Great Lakes middle ground was an artifice, a mutual fiction between people who hardly tolerated one another, but it survived because both sides needed it to survive. Word by word, concession by concession, the French and the Indians forged an alliance that stabilized the refugee triangle, allowing trade to flourish. Soon Jesuit missionaries followed. Suffused with utopian fantasies of La Nouvelle Jérusalem in the wilderness, they began building missions. The French-Indian alliance in the Great Lakes underwrote a dramatic expansion of the fur trade, which then thrust a gunpowder revolution into the Sioux world. Fleets of French traders and Odawa middlemen carried guns into the rich castor lands in the western Great Lakes, where greatest profits awaited. Sauteurs, Wyandots, Odawas, and other lakes people acquired enough guns to contain Iroquois war parties from the east, but they also carried their guns against the Ocheti Shakowin in the west. They needed more pelts to fuel the fur trade and more game to feed their crowded villages, and the largest concentration of both could be found in the lands of the Sioux. Wyandots, a French trader noted, so rash as to imagine that the Sioux were incapable of resisting them without iron weapons and firearms, joined forces with Odawas to drive out to secure a greater territory in which to seek their living. The refugee triangle began to bulge westward, turning the Ocheti Shakowin's eastern border into a battlefront. It was the kind of warfare Sioux had never seen. Trapped on the wrong side of the technological frontier, they had been cut off from a revolution that had multiplied their enemies' killing power. Sioux still relied on the energy of their own bodies to wage war. Stone points and bows had long ago amplified their capacity to inflict damage, but Sioux warriors were still constrained by the limits of human strength. The force of an axe stroke or the reach of an arrow ultimately depended on their own ability to generate power. Their enemies, however, now commanded unimaginable power that had been harnessed from the natural world and condensed into an explosive substance. Packed behind a bullet, gunpowder's sulfur, charcoal, and saltpeter produced a chemical reaction that sent a piece of hot lead at speed faster than an eye could see. Gunpowder provided more than an amplification of human power. It opened a way to tap into the immense energy stored in the Earth's mineral wealth. The muzzle-loading smoothbore flintlocks the enemies of the Sioux carried into battle were more than weapons. They channeled Washichun, mysterious and incomprehensible sacred power. The eastern border of the Sioux became a terrifying place, where they fought from a position of daunting material and psychological disadvantage, facing steel with flesh. They confronted enemies that could kill from distances far greater than their own weapons could reach, and suffered wounds their healers could not mend. Sauteurs became a terror unto them, waging a cruel war with instruments they never have seen. Sioux tried desperately to secure guns. They captured a party of Odawas, whom they called spirits because they had iron. They returned these spirits home and sent emissaries to Odawa villages. They wept over everyone they met, beseeching them to have pity on them and to share with them that iron which they regarded as a divinity. But the Odawas became contemptuous, dismissing them as people far inferior to themselves and as incapable even of waging war. They fired their guns, which so terrified the Sioux that they imagined it was the thunder or the lightning of which the Utawas had made themselves masters in order to exterminate whomsoever they would. The performance affirmed the inequity between the Odawas and the Sioux, and announced on which side power lay. Odawas and their allies wielded extraordinary powers, and had no intention of surrendering their advantage. Sioux loaded them with endearing terms and showed the utmost submissiveness, but this humiliating attitude only deepened Odawa's revulsion. Perhaps the struggles over hunting rights cut too deep, or perhaps the Sioux did not quite know the proper rituals of war and diplomacy of the Lakes world. Unlike their neighbors, Sioux did not burn their captives, considering it indecent for men to be so cruel, and their custom of ceremonial weeping was not common in the Lakes. Or perhaps there were simply too many of them. Whatever the reason, Sioux remained outsiders. Odawas, Wyandots, and others would shun alliances with them and keep driving into their hunting lands. The expanding refugee triangle was just one of many hostile fronts converging around the Ocheti Chaconwe. Looking east from their core region around Umda Huachan, Sioux faced enemies across an arc extending from the Leech Lake all the way south to the Des Moines Valley, a massive war zone where they fought some dozen nations vying for hunting rights, trade, and predominance. Then, disastrously, Crees and Sauteurs joined forces against them. The new allies, a terse French report noted, sent companies of soldiers to war against that great nation to capture its deep reserves of prime castor. Neither Crees nor Sauteurs had kinship ties with Sioux, and both considered them an alien people who could be killed and whose possessions could be taken. The enmity with Sauteurs was particularly damaging. Ranging across the length of Lake Superior's southern shore, Sauteurs could exert strong control over the western flow of guns and other trade goods and stop it from reaching the Sioux. Gunless and ironless, Sioux had to retreat. To avoid clashes with their many enemies, they increasingly hunted on the western side of the Mississippi, but this drew them into conflict with the Iowas, Siouan-speaking hunters and farmers who lived to the south of the Seven Fires and hunted bison in the grasslands west of them. On all sides, the Sioux domain began to cave in. Cree warriors pushed into Umda Huachan, threatening Sioux fisheries and rice fields. Sauteur war parties invaded Sioux hunting grounds through the western tip of Lake Superior, a natural gateway into the contested beaver trapping grounds. A group of Odawas settled on Prairie Island on the Mississippi and began to raise corn on Sioux lands. The power dynamics had become horribly stacked against the Ocheti Chaconwe. Yet the Seven Fires possessed a singular advantage. They were more numerous than any of their enemies, boasting a population that, by some estimates, was 30 times larger than that of the geopolitically privileged Sauteurs. Their isolation rendered them vulnerable, but it also protected them from contagious crowd diseases. There is no record of epidemic outbreaks in the Sioux country in the 17th century. Sheer numbers allowed Sioux to hold on. Their enemies could kill them, infringe on their lands, and steal their peltry, but they could not conquer or undo them. Sioux could bring thousands of warriors on a battlefield to keep out enemy war parties whose numbers rarely exceeded a few hundred. Numbers also made them impossible to ignore. The French traders who followed the refugee Indians west spoke of Onontio's love for his children, pledged to take care of their needs, and arm them against Sioux, but all the while French officers kept gazing past them at the Seven Fires, which had taken an unyielding hold of their imagination. A Nouvelle France was a small colony surrounded by much larger British ones and the formidable Iroquois, but how great might New France be with 30,000 Sioux on its side? The French seemed to have found in Sioux the key that could unlock the continent and its immense wealth for them. Yet they struggled to implement consistent policies to win the Sioux over. Having originated as an eclectic religious and commercial venture, New France did not seem to be able to decide the shape and character it should assume. Even after the king took the colony under his direct control in the 1660s, the French did not seem to be able to decide whether to center the Indian trade in Montreal through native middlemen, to concentrate it in fixed posts in the interior, or to allow coureurs de bois, runners of the woods, wide-ranging independent traders, to carry goods into distant Indian villages. The result was a constantly shifting and chronically unstable commercial and geopolitical landscape that remained Sioux's greatest challenge for nearly a century. They met it with a policy that was resolute in terms of ends, securing guns, iron, Onuncio's love and safety, and extraordinarily supple in terms of means. But first they needed to find openings. Dead or alive, you have the power over us. In the spring of 1660, a band of Mittawakontone Sioux walked for several days to visit Sautours, carrying the bones of their ancestors. They had been summoned 5 months earlier to a village by Ottawa Lake, south of Lake Superior, where a great gathering would take place. As they now made their way east, these Sioux entered a world of strangers and enemies who for years had tried to destroy them. But if the bones of their dead would join the bones of departed Sautours, the past could be buried, and the violence would end. The bones could remake the world in a ceremony the Indians knew as the Feast of the Dead. The peace process had been set in motion a year earlier by hunger and bloodshed. Pierre Esprit Radisson, a French adventurer trader, who was wintering among Sautours, wrote how his hosts, caught between the Iroquois to the east and the Sioux to the west, had become the very image of death. He also wrote of a massive battle between Sioux and allied Sautours and Crees. Many had died on both sides, and a Sautour chief had lost an eye by an arrow, but with his remaining eye, the chief had seen what had to be done. His courage being abject, he had announced that he himself should be ambassador and conclude the peace. He had traveled to Mille Lacs to reach out to Sioux, but the wound was yet fresh, and Sioux had recoiled. Sautours returned home, but within a year they made a new effort by calling the Sioux and Crees to a feast. Now the moment was at hand. When the Sioux ambassadors reached the Sautour village, they met Radisson, who was once again visiting Sautours, now with his brother-in-law, Médard Chouard de Grosier, who had been instrumental in opening the Great Lakes trade. The ambassadors seized the opportunity to forge ties with the French. Their wives, each had two, offered the Frenchmen gifts of wild rice and Indian corn. They then greased the Frenchmen's feet, undressed them, and clothed them with buffalo robes and white beaver skins. After this, they wept upon our heads until we were wetted by their tears, Radisson marveled. The ceremony culminated in the smoking of the calumet, which put an end to hostilities and created bonds of affinity and obligation. The ambassadors perfumed the clothes and armor of the Frenchmen, who in turn threw tobacco into a fire, causing a violent explosion, the Sioux's first experience of gunpowder. Almost all of this took place in silence. The ceremony resumed the next day, now in words and through an interpreter. The Indians sat down, but Radisson and de Grosier made a more elevated place for themselves to appear in more state. The Frenchmen accepted the calumet and told the envoys that they had taken them in their protection. French protection was precisely what the Sioux wanted if it translated into trade, guns, and iron. They had made themselves small and pitiful to invoke generosity. They stripped and dressed the strangers so that they could be born again as allies. This initial meeting between the Sioux and the Frenchmen was followed by 8 days of feasting, which then transformed into a grand council. 30 young Sioux men, armed with nothing but bows and arrows, their faces painted with many colors, and their ears pierced in 5 places, entered the council house. They were warriors, and they spoke of war, explaining how they had brought their wives with them to take their advice, for they had a mind to go against the Cristinos, Crees, who were ready for them. The fact that wives made themselves visible announced Sioux's commitment to end the violence that was consuming their world. Women's presence in public meetings conveyed peaceful intentions and helped create a common ground. The next day, with great gravity and modesty, Sioux elders entered the council lodge carrying calumets and dressed in long buffalo robes that reached the ground. While the ambassadors handed out gifts of beaver and buffalo skins, their spokesman made a speech of thanksgiving, declaring that they had come to make a sacrifice to the French. He implored the French to visit them and bring their merchandise to keep them alive. An old man placed a calumet at the Frenchman's feet, covered them with his robe, and spoke. "Ye are masters over us. Dead or alive, you have the power over us, and may dispose of us as your pleasure." Radisson and de Grosier imagined themselves as life-givers, who alone had the capacity to unite the fractured indigenous world with their goods and love. "We were come from the other side of the great salted lake," they told the assembled Indians, not to kill them but to make them live, acknowledging you for our brethren and children, whom we will love henceforth as our own. Because the fur trade required stability, they exhorted the Indians to commit to a universal peace all over the earth and urged the Sioux to embrace the Crees, whom the Frenchmen had already adopted. Sioux should lead them to the Dance of Union, which was to be celebrated at the Death's Feast and Banquet of Kindred. If Sioux continued their war with Crees, Radisson de Grosier warned, they would not see them in their villages. The Sioux ambassadors apparently said nothing. Radisson then traveled 3 days to a Cree encampment and brought back a delegation. The Cree emissaries melted into a large audience of Sauteurs, Sioux, Odawas, and others, who had gathered to witness the culmination of the Peace Council and the Feast of the Dead. Women danced to music, young men competed at climbing up a greased pole, and everyone took part in a feast, gift exchanges of most exquisite things to show what his country affords, ensued. The Frenchman received 300 beaver robes. Informal marriages were concluded, according to their country customs, turning strangers into relatives. Finally, the time came for the main participants to unite the bones. Sauteurs unearthed ancestral remains and bestowed them on Sioux, who reciprocated. Enemies held the bones of their enemies and reburied them in a common grave, thus resurrecting as relatives. More than 1,000 people watched as two redoubted nations did what they never before had. They became one. All this Radisson and de Grosier observed with growing delight. This feast ended, Radisson wrote, and all headed home well satisfied. The two adventurers thought they had pacified the interior and refitted it to the needs of the fur trade, but in truth they had played a role far smaller and more ambiguous. For all their humility and submissiveness, the Sioux ambassadors had arranged ceremonies and exchanges to forge a new reality where the Sauteurs could become allies, the French could become protectors, and trade could flow freely into their villages. What the Sioux needed was a thorough geopolitical realignment of the American interior. They needed the essential elements of power, the Wachichun of New France, the gun frontier, even the Sauteurs, to shift west. The Iroquois of this country. The Sioux vision for the West complemented French designs for the interior. Where Sioux wanted merchandise and peace to flow west, the French wanted furs and loyalty to flow east. Sioux superior hunters, whom Radisson called the Nation of the Beef, were the key to French designs. The animal-rich Sioux country promised to become what Mexico and Peru had been for Spain, a source of easily extractable wealth. But the French knew that it was too big and too distant to be claimed with missions and forts, the basic tools of French imperialism. Instead of bringing the French Empire among the Seven Fires, the agents had to bring the Seven Fires into the French Empire. And so the Feast of the Dead ended. Radisson and de Grosier headed west with a party of Sauteurs to deliver the Sioux into the fold. During the council with Sauteurs, Sioux emissaries had boasted to Radisson and de Grosier about the many attractions of their country. Working hard to enhance their reputation, they promised the Frenchmen would find smooth roads and bridges across rivers for not to wet our feet. More pointedly, they assured that the lodges of their wives and daughters would always be open to them, a promise of intermarriages that would cement an alliance by turning the French into kin. When the pair arrived after 7 small journeys, they were not disappointed. They were taken to the Umdawakan area, the spiritual and political center of the Sioux world, where they found themselves in a town of skin cabins. They were told that there were 7,000 men. This we believed. They also seemed to believe that there were mines of copper, pewter, and lead, as well as mountains covered with a kind of stone that is transparent and tender and like to that of Venice. Radisson learned how the Sioux retire in winter towards the woods of the north, where they kill a quantity of castors. He believed their pelts were the best in the whole world. Cree lands, he concluded, were richer in castor, but Sioux castor was far better. Radisson and de Grosier stayed for 6 weeks and left loaded with booty. Things changed rapidly after this. The refugee triangle had long been the primary destination of French traders, but now commercial gravity shifted north and west around a Sauteur-Sioux axis. A small resource-rich peninsula at the southwestern corner of Lake Superior, the French knew as Le Pointe de Shawamigan, became the focal point of the interior trade. Shawamigan belonged to Sauteurs, and their villages became a cosmopolitan neutral zone, a Babylon of libertinism, where guns, food, and captives exchanged hands, where customs and ceremonies blended, and where new kin were made. Jesuits built a mission, Saint-Esprit, for the swelling native population. More than 50 villages can be counted, the priests rejoiced, which comprised diverse people, either nomadic or stationary, who depend in some sort on this mission. Sioux, too, benefited from the rise of the Sauteurs. With the bones of their ancestors now resting near Shawamigan, they were welcome at the region's thriving fairs, where they found ready markets for their coveted castor. At long last, guns and iron became available. And just as they explained to Radisson and de Grosier, trade brought peace. To their southeast, the formidable Illinois raided slaves across a widening zone, were simultaneously fighting a two-front war against the Sioux and Iroquois. Desperate to carry their slaves through Sioux territory to the Lake Superior gun markets, Illinois approached the Seven Fires and made peace with them in order to facilitate their coming to La Pointe. Sioux had won a tenuous access to an enormously complex world, and they had to quickly learn how to navigate it. Careful not to alarm their new allies, they visited the Shawamigan fairs only in small numbers and as if on an embassy. Like the Iroquois, they had to tread cautiously on the margins of the shared Indian and French world that was coalescing in the western Great Lakes. Jesuits dubbed them as the Iroquois of this country beyond La Pointe. The Feast of the Dead may have joined them to Sauteurs, but they remain foreigners to most Lakes Indians. They speak a language that is utterly foreign, the savages here not understanding it at all, the Jesuits observed, and their manners and customs are quite extraordinary. To the Jesuits, whose sensibilities had been molded in decades of proselytizing among more sedentary Indians, the Sioux seemed unworldly and vulgar. Their Calumet-centered ceremonies seemed pathetically simple, and their hospitality verged on the insulting. When any stranger arrives, complained Father Jacques Marquette, they feed him with a wooden fork, as one would a child. Their acts of generosity and kindness misinterpreted, and their pleas for pity ignored, Sioux remained outsiders. They had made a concerted effort to be accepted and included, and it had failed. The carefully fashioned realm of good thoughts fractured, and violence flowed into the cracks. By the late 1660s, Sioux were once again at war with most of their neighbors, who held them in extreme fear. The access points to the eastern markets through Shawamigan closed up, and they turned inward. "They have the wild oats," Marquette wrote, "and keep their world inviolate." Sensing a growing detachment, Marquette sent them gifts and a message that they must show due recognition to the Frenchman wherever they met him and must not kill him or the savages accompanying him. Their response gave him a pause. Sioux refused to visit Shawamigan and rejected the gifts. "I could wish that all the nations had as much love for God as these people have fear of the French," the dejected priest complained. "Christianity would soon be flourishing." Another missionary wrote of a king of the great nation of the Naudowessiuq who reigns over a vast country beyond the Vermilion Sea. There was no such king, of course. As the Sioux became increasingly aloof, imagination started to replace facts. French assertions of Sioux detachment may have been exaggerated. There was so much in the interior world the French could not see or know, but it did not matter. Perceptions bled into policies, and the Seven Fires were once more deemed strangers. When they were paired with the Iroquois, who were tearing down New France, they had already lost their quest for centrality. Occasional traders would visit them, but iron and guns would concentrate elsewhere, consigning them to the receiving end of the native arms race. Odawas entrenched themselves in the Straits of Mackinac between Lakes Huron and Michigan, a key gateway to the west, where they were ideally positioned to dominate the reviving fur trade. 500 miles and thousands of merchandise-hungry Indians separated the Sioux from the Straits, leaving them isolated and vulnerable. "They have eaten me to the bone." In around 1670, Sioux captured a Wyandot hunting party from Shawamigan that had entered their lands. One Sioux chief was so incensed by this that he nearly attacked the young man who had seized the Wyandots. The chief had recently sung the calumet to Sinagos, a brutal slaver and war chief of Odawas, who were close allies of Wyandots, and he was desperate to protect this lifeline for his village. He decided to personally deliver the Wyandot captives home and set out with three warriors and a woman. When approaching Shawamigan, however, the Wyandots fled. At the village, they said they'd escaped certain death in Sioux hands. The Sioux ambassadors continued to Shawamigan regardless and were cordially received by Sinagos. But the Wyandots convinced Sinagos to hand the Sioux over to them. They boiled and ate them. Things fell apart after this. Sioux retaliated by killing Wyandots and Odawas, who responded by killing Sioux. The Sioux-Sotor alliance dissolved into chaos, and the lands between Lake Superior and Imdawakan became a battleground. The French tried to mediate, but the bloodshed escalated through kinship networks as grieving men sought to revenge slain relatives. Enmities congealed into hatreds, and violence swept over the length of the Ocheti-Chaukoin's eastern border, where a general league had formed against a common foe. Musquakis, whose lands west of Green Bay butted against the Sioux domain, were fully resolved not to treat the Sioux more humanely than they are treated by them. Yet the border held. Enemy war parties raided along the Mississippi, turning it into a battlefront, but few risked pushing into the Sioux country beyond the river. Some 30 large Dakota, Yankton, Yanktonai, and Lakota villages dotted the vast realm, each protected by boggy marshes, and each ready to pull together and give prompt aid wherever it is needed. They made themselves feared by all their neighbors, using the bow and arrow with such skill and readiness as to fill the air with shafts in an instant. Now exceedingly numerous, Sioux seized the initiative and carried the war to their enemies, striking deep into the Great Lakes. The result was a massive diaspora. If in the 1650s the Iroquois had been a hammer that pounded westward fleeing refugees against an anvil that were the Sioux, in the 1670s the positions were reversed. Sioux now delivered the blows while Iroquois remained passive. The western Great Lakes began to empty as people either fled or wasted away. The peninsula linking Lake Superior, Michigan, and Huron became a new refugee center for people who had been twice dispossessed in a single generation. The Jesuits abandoned Shawamigan and moved east to Sault Ste. Marie. There they rejoiced how the fear of the Sioux pushed the refugees almost in one spot, making it easier for the priests to find them and show them the road to heaven. More concerned with survival in this world, the refugees embraced the Jesuits and their god as life-givers who could help them destroy the Sioux. A Sautour chief, his body coated with scars from years of fighting the Iroquois and Sioux, thanked the Jesuits for praying for us to Jesus, the god of war. In 1672, the Lakes Indians mobilized French resources against the Sioux. Odawas visited Montreal and brought back only muskets and powder, intending to march against the Sioux, build a fort in their country, and wage war against them during the entire winter. When Sinagos moved Odawas toward the Sioux country across the refugee zone, handing out gifts, his party kindled kinship obligations in village after village, becoming a mobile rallying point for shared vengeance, a body of over 1,000 men, all having guns or other powerful weapons of defense. Sinagos' army managed to surprise small villages, but Sioux quickly regrouped and slew them in great numbers, for their terror was so overwhelming that in their flight they had thrown away their weapons. Nearly all of them perished by fighting, by hunger, or by the rigor of the climate. Demoralized, the coalition collapsed into infighting. The disorder among them was so great that they ate one another. Sioux captured Sinagos and decided to make a statement. Unwilling to burn the prominent chief, they made him go to a repast, and cutting pieces of flesh from his thighs and all other parts of his body, broiled these and gave them to him to eat, informing Sinagos that, as he'd eaten so much human flesh and shown himself so greedy for it, he might now satiate himself upon it by eating his own. Then they sent one of Sinagos's slaves back home so that he might faithfully report what he had seen and the justice that had been administered. If this was an attempt to intimidate Odawas or to communicate restraint, it did not work. Lakes Indians remained resolute to destroy and consume the Sioux. In the midst of the bloodshed, Muscutans and Illinois invited Father Claude-Jean Allouet to what seemed to be a feast for fighting. "You have heard of the peoples called Nadouessi," the master of the feast told the Jesuits. "They have eaten me to the bone, and have not left me a single member of my family alive. I must taste of their flesh, as they have tasted of that of my kinsfolk. I am ready to set out against them in war, but I despair of success therein unless you, who are the masters of life and of death, are favorable toward me in this undertaking." Alway heard the pleas, but flinched at mass violence. The Jesuits, he explained to his distraught audience, were but the weak servants of the great God of armies. It took a threat from another European empire to prompt the French into action. 10,000 Onontios. In 1670, dreadful news reached New France. King Charles II of England had charted a new fur trading enterprise and granted it a monopoly over all lands whose rivers drained into Hudson Bay, an area 15 times the size of England. Making matters worse, Radisson and de Grozier, the pioneer trader explorers, had grown disillusioned with the prospects of the French fur trade and deserted, taking their deep savoir-faire of indigenous diplomacy to the service of London merchants, who seemed to possess not only the money, but an unfettered commercial focus to fulfill the pair's dream of an inland fur empire. Hudson Bay lay hundreds of miles to the north and west of the St. Lawrence Valley, the spine of New France, but it anchored a vast fan-shaped river system that opened multiple entryways to the interior. Suddenly, the English seemed poised to reach nearly every native nation in the interior, threatening to cut off New France from its hinterland. The news came at a particularly unfortunate time for the French. The Sioux Wars had effectively closed the west beyond Lake Huron to trade. This presented a mortal threat for New France, whose empire did not exist outside of its Indian alliance system. The eastward retreat of the Lakes Indians also meant an eastward retreat of the French Empire. The Pays d'Onol, the sphere where French traders, missionaries, and soldiers could safely operate, had shrunk dangerously. This alone would have been damaging, but the contraction occurred just as a new imperial rival entered the scene in the form of the Hudson's Bay Company. The French did what they habitually did when facing imperial crises. They reached out to Indians. In the summer of 1671, a seasoned inland trader, Nicolas Perrault, brought Simon-François Daumont de Saint-Luzon to Sault Ste. Marie, where in front of Jesuit priests and 2,000 natives, the commissary claimed for Louis XIV all the territories lying between the east and the west, from Montreal as far as the South Sea, covering the utmost extent and range possible. The pageant was meant to preempt English claims to the interior, but it was delivered to the people who mattered most, the Indians, whose allegiance made and unmade European empires in 17th century North America. The pageant was also a response to the Indians' pleas for French aid. Saint-Luzon had come to offer the king's iron and protection to his suffering children and to renew their alliance. In return, he expected obedience. "You know about Onontio, that famous captain of Quebec," Father Alway exhorted the Indians through a translator. "Beyond the sea there are 10,000 Onontios like him, who are only the soldiers of that great captain, our great king." "Not only did this king decide all the affairs of the world," Alway explained, warming up to his topic, "but he had enough hatchets to cut down all your forests and kettles to cook all your moose." The priest who recorded the speech may have considered it somewhat grandiose. Regardless of the historical weight of the occasion, he cut his account short, simply noting, "The father added much more of this sort." When the ceremony ended, Saint-Luzon set out west in search of the Northwest Passage, a fabled water route across the continent to the South Sea, the Pacific Ocean. With the Lakes Indians back in the fold, the French gazed to the west, dreaming of unforeseen riches. But others dreamt too, and not of commerce or cities of gold. The multi-ethnic native community that had sprung up in Sault Ste. Marie under the shadow of Sioux War had become something of a Jesuit success story. This place, to which the abundance of white fish caught there gives considerable importance, daily becomes more beautiful and more comfortable, especially since the savages apply themselves to planting Indian corn there. In the deep interior, Sioux aggression was pushing the French and the Indians to tighten their bonds. As long as there were horror-struck people who blackened themselves and fasted in order to dream of the nod to a sea, the French and their god and guns would be needed. Without knowing it, Sioux held the future of France's North American empire in their hands. The English challenge to French dominion had made the Ochetti Chacoin a pivot around which the continent's imperial fortunes turned. War between France and Sioux could deliver the interior to England, whereas peace between the two could secure it for France. Though largely unaware of their geopolitical weight, Sioux could nonetheless capitalize on it. They seem to have already begun a conciliation with Sauteurs when, in the winter of 1678-79, the Sauteur leader Omar Mans met Marie-Danielle Guesselon du Lute, a fiercely ambitious French trader at Sault Ste. Marie. Omar Mans saw in du Lute a useful mediator who, as an Ontario's representative, could extend the French alliance among the Sioux and Sauteurs. Omar Mans took the eager Frenchman on, and in the spring escorted him to the western end of Lake Superior, where they came to a mixed Sioux-Sauteur village. Sioux and Sauteurs had already begun to forge peace. Du Lute, it seems, was brought in to open access to French goods that would make the Sioux-Sauteur alliance powerful and enduring. Sioux and Sauteurs made peace on the very ground over which they had clashed. When the conference ended, they sojourned among one another on the marshy borderlands between their domains, turning them into a common ground. A year later, Du Lute invited Crees and Assiniboines to a rendezvous near the western tip of Lake Superior to make peace with an Sioux, their common enemy. The Indians spent the winter hunting together in the forests somewhere about Du Lute's camp, burying grievances and becoming relatives. Abruptly and decisively, the interior geopolitics had swung around a prodigious Sioux-Sauteur-Cree-Assiniboine alliance. If not earlier, it was now obvious that, rather than the world-changer he imagined himself to be, Du Lute was but a useful instrument in native diplomacy that followed its own goals and course. His hero fantasy collapsing, Du Lute retreated to it. Reporting to Quebec and Paris, he cast himself as a latter-day conquistador merchant who had engineered a crucial indigenous alliance which could be expanded to wrench the entire Indian trading system from the English orbit back toward New France. In true New World adventurer tradition, Du Lute believed he could achieve this almost single-handedly. He worked tirelessly to realize his ambition, at times seriously hurting English ventures and winning favor with the governor of New France, but his efforts would not bring a single sou to Montreal to suckle the Sioux with his breast. Sioux did not want to go east, neither as diplomats nor as traders. They wanted people to come to them. They wanted the French to bring iron to their villages, and they wanted their allies to live with them. To be powerful in late 17th century North America meant having allies and kin. Distances were enormous, and people lived far apart, which meant that access to resources, goods, humans, markets was critical. So was the capacity not to move. Travel was dangerous and arduous. It took French traders 3 to 4 weeks to paddle downriver from western Lake Superior to Montreal, and twice the time to paddle back, which meant that immobility connoted power. The weaker traveled to the more powerful, and markets were not so much opened as brought in. The French did just that. In 1681, Jean-Baptiste Colbert, Louis XIV's Minister of Finance, announced a new form and purpose for France's North American empire. Instead of a fixed enterprise centered on the St. Lawrence, Colbert now envisioned an expanding commercial sphere extending deep into the interior. The impromptu arrangement of independent traders and native middlemen was replaced by a congé system of trade licenses and permanent posts. The coureurs de bois were legalized. Colbert's edict opened inland trade just as the Sioux-Sauteur peace made the interior safe for French traders. The result was a flood of traders to the west. The fur trade and trapping had declined during the relentless wars, and the Sioux country became known as a nursery of beavers, a luring pool of wealth just beyond reach. With Colbert's reversal, the pent-up demand for Sioux castor carried the gun and iron frontier into the Sioux country in a single lunge. The number of guns reaching the west in the 1680s may have doubled from the previous decade. Coureurs de bois pushed among Sioux from the western tip of Lake Superior, and Du Lute sent traders through Green Bay and the Fox and Wisconsin rivers, where canoeists had to negotiate but a short portage and a few rapids. It was a natural route to the Sioux country and soon became the main pathway into the West. Enjoying a generous commission from the governor, Duluth built a post in the headwaters of the Qua River with an easy access from the core of the Sioux country around Mdewakan. At long last, Sioux had broken Lakes people's grip on the fur trade and opened access to guns and iron. This was a terrifying development for the Great Lakes Indians. All of a sudden, French traders began to push through their lands to arm their archenemies. Emboldened, Sioux and Sautour sent in 1681 a force of 800 warriors against Musquaquies, whose villages near the Wisconsin Fox Route threatened their lifeline to the French. They killed 56. Musquaquies, along with others, accused the French of betrayal and started attacking Sioux, trying to divert the flow of goods into their own villages. French agents worked hard to appease all, mediating quarrels, handing out gifts, and arranging murder trials. No one worked harder than Perrault, France's most proficient Indian trader and envoy, who now became a linchpin of French ambitions in the West. Practiced in indigenous diplomacy, he presented himself as the embodiment of the French-Indian alliance. Facing an angry Musquaquie village in 1683, he addressed them with arresting bravado. "I have learned that you are very desirous to eat the flesh of Frenchmen. I have come with these young men whom you see to satisfy you. Put us into your kettles and gorge yourselves with the meat that you have been wanting." Musquaquies recoiled, refusing to eat, to kill, their father, and the emboldened Perrault demanded submission. "Vomit up your prey. Give me back my body. If you cook it, it will stir up vapors that will form stormy clouds which will extend over your village, which will be in a moment consumed by the flames and lightnings that will issue from them." Nothing more was necessary to secure the return of the captives, he concluded. 2 years later, Perrault, the self-designated savior of France's Western Empire, made a bid to consolidate the Sioux alliance. Launching from Green Bay with Abenaki refugees from New England, he intended to build a post on Sioux land. But the plan, word of which soon spread across the region, alarmed Musquitans and Kickapoos. For decades, the flow of French goods had stopped at their villages, whereas Perrault's endeavor would make the Sioux the terminus, reducing Musquitan and Kickapoo lands to a mere thoroughfare, just as the fur trade was starting to boom. Musquitans and Kickapoos pleaded with Perrault not to abandon them and asked him to show the place in the West where they should light their fires. They sought, in effect, to expand their realm westward with the fur trade by piggybacking on Perrault's venture. Suspended between old allies and new, between the eastern past and the western future of the French Empire, Perrault made a tortured compromise. He presented Musquitans and Kickapoos the Calumet and promised to always offer his breast for them to suckle. They would follow him to the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.